two of the best players of their generation. A combination worth £364 million. Two deals supposedly within the confines of financial fair play. World football's spotlight has turned to Paris Saint-Germain like never before after their purchases from Barcelona and Monaco, with teen Mbappe on a one-season loan, with a permanent deal worth £166 million to follow next season. But not all the attention has been focused on the fantasy footballer Unai Emery's side should be capable of producing this season. Live stream every round of League One on Bein Sports with the Foxtel Sports Pack. Get your free 2-week Foxtel Now trial and start watching in minutes. Sign up now. Greater than the money being thrown about as a sinister side that exposes a new part of football that threatens to get out of control, and it centers around the sale of Paris Saint-Germain to Qatar Sports Investment, the original sin in the Neymar transfer timeline. QSI is owned effectively by the royal family in Qatar, explains James Montague, author of The Billionaires Club, a book released this month about the rise of football's super iconas, the investment that Qatar has put into football. They didn't buy PSG because they're massive French football fans. Kylian Mbappe and Neymar Jr. of Paris Saint-Germain. Source: Getty Images. They invest in things with far greater profit margins than football clubs give them. This level of investment is another example of soft power and for leverage to put it on a level playing field with the rest of the international community. It's self-promotion basically. PSG has been budding to become a major player on the UEFA Champions League stage for some time. But why these massive outlays now? Why the outrageous spending on Neymar while his release clause was still in the picture? Why Mbappe now, while they can only get him on loan with FFP clause circling? Montague explains that Neymar and Mbappe, who he dubs from the generation of Instagram players, present a serious publicity coup for not just PSG, but Qatar itself, at a price that, to them, is a drop in the ocean. It can't be ignored that the timing is fantastic for Qatar, which is currently under siege quite literally from a blockade from its Arab neighbors. It's surviving at the moment from its massive reserves from natural gas. He added, it's a huge rally around the flag effect. This has shown they're quite literally under siege. This is a rare good news story and is being seen as such, and that's where it becomes murkier. Sheikh Mansour at Manchester City, or QSI at Paris Saint-Germain, ostensibly appear as separate entities to the United Arab Emirates, or Qatar states from which they come. Not quite. Qatar is a tiny country. The number of nationals and royal family members is tiny. Everything comes from the emir down, Montague explained. Paris Saint-Germain's Brazilian forward Neymar CL with Mbappe. Source: of everything is given via patronage. You are literally talking about people in the same family doing business. Qatar Airways was used as a way of legally investing in countries where there was an ExCo member who would vote on the 2022 World Cup bid. They now own football clubs in Belgium and Spain. And then of course you have PSG. When you look at all this, the former crown prince, now the emir, was intimately involved in all of this. If you look at the France football investigation into the 2010 World Cup fiasco, you have Sarkozy, the crown prince, Nasser, al-Khelaifi, all in the same room with Platini. Platini denied that pressure was put on him to vote for Qatar, but PSG was later sold to QSI, Paris Saint-Germain's fans. Source of Paris Saint-Germain's Uruguayan forward Edinson Cavani. Source of people think it's private wealth, but that's a fundamental misunderstanding of Middle East autocracy. People's jobs are given to them by the royal family. 99% of private sector is foreigners working. Qatar and UAE as well. This a very small coterie of royals and financial investment vehicles all connected by blood. It's impossible to separate them as separate entities. Financial fair play is supposed to intervene to stop this limitless clout ruining the game as we know it. It's clear that since its inception, FFP has been diluted because clubs can get around it. For example, PSG and City, with inflated sponsorship deals, he added, especially Qatar Airways and Etihad Airways, which are effectively state airlines. They offer massively inflated deals and are owned by the same family. UEFA did try to punish them, but the punishment was a drop in the ocean. Paris Saint-Germain's new forward Kylian Mbappe holds his jersey during his presentation. Source: AFP. Now you've got Chinese investment coming in, and that's different. It's kind of a state-planned attempt to take over of football and the business of sport as an entertainment product. It is powerful in sending a message, and you can send a message to as many people as possible. A powerful, powerful tool. It's only going to get worse. It can be ruinous to football as we understand it, in terms of clubs being wedded to local community and be it representative to you and who you are. Montague explains that the idea for the book actually came to fruition in Australia in 2014, having watched David Villa run out for Melbourne City, 6 years after Sheikh Mansour bought Manchester City. At the start they tell you it's a guy who loved football. Then you see it as a political business and its tentacles have grown across the world, he reflected. Paris Saint-Germain's new forward Kylian Mbappe are together with Paris Saint-Germain's Qatari president Nasser al-Khelaifi. A source of Pitt dawned on me: ownership is a strategy for whatever end you want to achieve. For Sheikh Mansour, this was about soft power for the UAE. Nothing promotes a country better than football. And nothing launders a reputation more thoroughly than football. That's especially so with the bright lights of success blinding fans from the reality bubbling behind the scenes. It always known from living in the United Arab Emirates that there was significant human rights issues, and where the money had come from wasn't necessarily ethical. The UAE is built on slave labor, essentially, and has zero democracy. Sheikh Mansour is one of the most powerful men in the country, but people weren't talking about that when the deal was struck. They were talking about Robinho, Dzeko. Montague's conclusion is a dark one, with this watershed social media signing a sign of how investors from across the globe, be it Middle East, Chinese, American, or wherever, will look to secure European assets for their own traction. The game will wither and die in English. What most people are buying into is the look and sound of English football, but this untethering of football from its geographical roots has important ramifications. Brazil's Neymar is now the world's most expensive footballer. Source AFP: CFG has a stake in clubs in Japan, Melbourne, New York, Uruguay. Red Bull has clubs in Austria, Germany and the US. King Power with Leicester and again in Belgium. This is the future, and the future will not only destroy fundamental things that make football great. You'll get franchise teams replacing local clubs. You'll see Barcelona, Beijing v Manchester City in Beijing. All that football knowledge and history, gone. It's still important to preserve and build on it, and that's the danger. And ultimately, at the center of this circus are just two football players. It is quite sad. What no one is talking about is the player as a footballer. As a player, at the center of this is a human being, a very good footballer, and the kind of pressure is huge. You just wonder, he has to score goals and has to perform, and we forget the center of this story is a human being who has to go out with all of this weighing down on his shoulders. In a way, it's madness.